Robert participated in many minor skirmishes throughout his service in South Korea. The largest and most famous was the Battle of Horseshoe Ridge on April 23, 1951. The 1st Marine Division met the Chinese and North Korean opposition in a series of attacks that enabled the Americans to gather into more concentrated fighting positions. At an unknown point in his service in South Korea, Robert's company captured a group of 3 communist POWs. These men said that they were South Koreans in the hope that they would be set free. The POWs were turned over to the main base to be dealt with. On the front lines, the troops had to deal with rough conditions and were sometimes issued supplies that were left over from World War II.
It was pretty primitive. We were on the front lines most of the time. You just put your sleeping bag wherever you could, if you could get some sleep, and sleep wherever you could. Occasionally, we might be on the front lines for a month or two, and then we would go back in reserve for a week. And when we were in reserve, sometimes we'd get a chance to take a bath and get hot meals and sleep in a tent to kind of recuperate and then go back in on the front line. So they kind of rotated us occasionally.
I'm sure the government paid a premium price for them, but you got a box that had 3 cans. That you got a day's ration each day. And it consisted of 3 cans of food and 1 can of dry rations, which had soluble coffee and a small pack of cigarettes and matches and a hard cookie. The canned food was, I remember, spaghetti, one of them, had 2 meatballs in the can, and beanie weenies, that's what I survived on for a year. There was one box, we called it the UN Trio. If you happened to select that box, you starved to death because you couldn't eat anything in the can. You just had to throw it away.
What was it?
I think it was kind of like a rice hash, or kind of like a some kind of hash and rice. I can't remember the other two, but it wasn't fit to eat.
Were the boxes labeled, or did you just kind of have luck of the draw?
Just luck of the draw. I used to like the spaghetti. One day I was eating a meatball and had a little white speck sticking out of it, so I went to pulled it out, and it was just an intestine about 3 foot long inside the meatball, just meat packed around it. It's all the meatballs were just tripe inside, a little bit of meat on the outside, so I couldn't eat the spaghetti after that.
I can't blame you.
it was horrible food.
Robert's company was lucky to get a full shower once a month. Lakes and ponds were often used for getting clean and having a little fun. Life in Korea was difficult, but as resilient young men, they managed to make the best out of a bad situation. They somehow managed to find time for badminton, swimming, and plain old goofing off. Robert, as a sergeant, was issued a very small amount of beer to be consumed whenever possible. This made him extremely popular, at least until the beer ran out. On May 2, 1951, Robert became a father.
A Marine corpsman brought a note to our commanding officer, our captain of the company, that they had received from the Naval Air Station in Corpus that the wife had gave birth to our son.
On May 2, 1951, his wife Charlene gave birth to Robert Lee Whitley Jr. in the Corpus Christi Naval Hospital. Meanwhile, the situation was becoming more intense. With American troops deep within enemy territory, the North Koreans now had a tactical advantage. Luckily for Robert, his 3-year tour of duty was completed before major combat forced a stalemate along the 38th parallel. Robert sent a telegram to his family to inform them that he was coming home. On November 27, 1951, he boarded the USS General John Pope and headed for San Francisco.
We wrote to each other regularly, you know, even when he was out on the front lines, he was good about writing to me whenever he can. So in December of 51, all at once his letters stopped, totally. And this went on for about 3 weeks, nothing. And we didn't know what to think. And finally, the letters that I had been sending him started coming back, and they said, rotated on them. Well, they didn't know what rotated meant. But one day we were listening to the radio, back in the old days when people listened to radios, and they were talking about a troop ship that had landed in San Francisco, and 3 local young men were on that troop ship. And he was one of them. Even knowing that, we knew he was in the United States, but he still didn't write us and let us know he was home. Now, apparently that telegram was supposed to have been sent, but we did not get that telegram. And Christmas, it was, you know, right at Christmas. And no sign of him, no note from him, no nothing, you know. And Christmas Day, he hadn't shown up yet, and I was sitting on the couch by a window looking up to the driveway, feeling sorry for myself, and his mother was changing the baby's diaper, and I looked out, and here he comes walking up the driveway.
On Christmas Day.
On Christmas Day. That was the nicest Christmas present
I've ever had.
One of the most memorable. That was the most memorable Christmas I've ever had in my life. I wish I could imprint the picture of him walking down the driveway. Yeah, it was a gorgeous picture. That's the only thing I can say. It was just beautiful.
Upon returning home, Robert got to meet his son for the very first time, as well as begin to rebuild his life after the experiences he just went through. He was able to go to college because of the GI Bill and received a Bachelor of Science in Engineering. He worked for Westinghouse for 25 years as an electrical engineer, traveling the world.
Hear that lonesome whippoorwill. He sounds too blue to fly. The midnight train is whining low. I'm so lonesome I could cry. I've never seen a night so long when time goes crawling by. The moon just went behind the clouds to hide